Welcome to Calvary Bible Baptist Church. Those that are here, appreciate your faithfulness. Those that are watching, we encourage you to come to church. The Bible says, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is. That means that there are people that forsake the assembling, but we encourage you not to and to come, especially in these last days, amen. And here at Calvary Bible Baptist Church, we'd like you to come and grow with us, not just watch us grow. Let's do our weekly Bible trivia. A weekly Bible trivia. What's the name of the city where Isaac and Abimelech made their covenant? Was it Philistia, Jerusalem, Gerar, or Bathsheba? Bathsheba? Is that the last? Is that the final answer? Bathsheba it is. Genesis chapter 26, 23. And he, that's Isaac, Abimelech. Went up from thence to Beersheba. Then Abimelech went, oh no, that was Isaac, sorry. Then verse 26, and Abimelech went to him from Gerar, and Ahuzath, one of his friends, and Pichol, the chief captain of his army. And Isaac said unto him, wherefore come ye to me, seeing ye hate me, and have sent me away from you? And they said, we saw certainly that the Lord was with thee, and we said, let there be now an oath betwixt us, even betwixt us and thee, and let us make a covenant with thee. So the covenant was made between Abimelech and Isaac in Beersheba. And Beersheba means a covenant. And that's also the city where Abraham made the covenant with Abimelech. A very noteworthy city. All right, a lot of history there. All right, very good. This week's memory verse. Anybody remember? It's I'll give you a hint. Philippians 1:6, I believe. Philippians 1:6. Good. Amen. Anybody else want to give a crack at it? A little bit. Being confident in this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. We are a work in progress. You know, God made the stars also. It was kind of an afterthought. He made the stars also. He created the world in an instant in 6 days, but yet you and I are still a work in progress. Isn't that something? Amen. So, very good. Philippians 1:6, being confident in this very thing. All right, get your pens out, get your paper out, get ready for next week's memory verse. Next week's memory verse is Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Exodus chapter 20, verse 12. Honor thy father and thy mother, that thy days may be long upon the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. Too bad there was no kids in here. That would be a good verse for them, amen. That's the first commandment with promise. That's the first commandment with promise, is to honor thy father and mother, and your days will be extended. Amen. So Exodus chapter 20, verse 12 for next week. All right, let's get into the Bible study this morning. Genesis chapter 27, verse 2. Genesis chapter 27, verse 2. And he said, behold, now I am old, I know not the day of my death. Now therefore take, I pray thee, thy weapons, thy quiver, and thy bow, and go out to the field, and take me some venison, and make me savory meat such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, that my soul may bless thee before I die. Let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for saving our souls. We thank you for this church. We thank you for your son dying on Calvary's cross. Lord, this morning we pray that we'd hear from you, hear from your word, Lord, that you'd be most welcome in this place. And Lord, Heavenly Father, we do pray for souls to be saved. We thank you for those that have been saved, Lord. And we pray for Christians to be encouraged, to be edified. And Lord, Heavenly Father, we pray that you'd come back soon. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. So here in this passage of Scripture, we see that Isaac is conversing with Esau. And Esau is the firstborn. He's the firstborn of the family of Isaac. And Isaac is going to give him the blessing. And here, Isaac anticipates his death. If you would, Genesis chapter 27. Isaac anticipates his death. In verse 2, he says, I am old, and I know not the day of my death. And in so doing, he's preparing his death by passing on the blessing of the firstborn and appropriating the items of the household. If you would, go to Genesis 27:4. and make me savory meat, such as I love, and bring it to me that I may eat, and my soul may bless thee before I die. So Isaac was correct in giving the blessing in anticipation for his death. This would be like somebody getting up there in age, they make a will, they appropriate where things are going to go after they die. It's not something that's pleasant, it's not something that's fun that we want to do, but it is a good thing to do. It is prudent to do in the household and the family as the head of the home. And so that's what Isaac is doing. It's wise and prudent to be prepared to set physical and spiritual things in order in the household. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 22, verses 3 and 27, verse 12, a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself. You know, it's a prudent thing to look to the future and to prepare for the future. And Isaac is very wise in that. As a matter of fact, you should live that way. You should live planning for the worst, but hoping for the best. Amen. And planners, those that fail to plan, plan to fail. Amen. There's an old quote. And we should have planning in our life. And, you know, what separates humans from other animals is the thought of the future. Animals only think for the day, to get the food, to survive that day. Humans are the one and only creatures that can think about tomorrow and hope for tomorrow and have hope in general. And so human beings can plan and hope and predict and plan for the future, and God has given that for us. But know that just because you plan doesn't mean it always comes through. The best laid plans of mice and men can always fall through, amen? But it's good to plan, and it's wise to plan. And Isaac is doing that, but the problem that Isaac has is he's doing it carnally. If you would, take a look in Genesis chapter 26. Give me a second here. Verses 3 through 4. Now therefore, take, I pray thee, thy weapons. He's talking to Esau. He's going to bless Esau, or so he thinks. Take thy weapons, thy quiver, and thy bow, and go to the field, and make me some venison, and make me savory meat, such as I love, and bring it to me, that I may eat, that my soul may bless thee before I die. Instead of being in prayer, and maybe fasting, taking this blessing a little more seriously, Isaac is concerned about the carnal. He's concerned about filling his belly. He's concerned about getting filled up with food, and being content physically. There's nothing wrong with being filled with food, nothing wrong with eating. We have to do it to live, but it's a carnal thing, and he's focusing on the carnal instead of the spiritual. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13 says this. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 13, meats for the belly and the belly for meats, but God shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for fornication, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. The belly for the meats and the meats for the belly. That's meat is for the belly and it will perish. It's carnal. It's temporary. What Isaac is appropriating to Esau is going to be spiritual. Okay? Now most of us, if we do a will for our death, that's dealing also with carnal things. But this is the household of God. This is the nation of Israel. This is a special household. And this is going to stem the nation of Israel. And Isaac is dealing with spiritual things here. He's dealing with spiritual things, but he's got carnal pleasures on his mind. And that's why when we come to church, when we come to gather for the Lord, we need to get those carnal things out of our mind. We need to be stayed on Christ. We need to be set on Christ. You know, the Bible says, set your affections on things above, not on things in this earth. Why? Because we have a tendency to do that. We have a tendency to think about the carnal, the immediate. And we live in a carnal world, and we have flesh. And so we have a tendency to look that way. And Isaac, he's about to give the blessing of Abraham, but he has his mind on carnal things. Romans chapter 14, verse 23 says this, and he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So you can do the right thing the wrong way, and it still be the wrong thing. Say, what do you mean? Well, Isaac has the right intent. He has the intent to give the blessing. He knows he's going to die, but he's going about it the wrong way. Like many Christians, Isaac did the right thing the wrong way. A pastor talks about this time and judgment, doing the right thing the right way. Genesis chapter 27, verse 2. Genesis chapter 27, verse 2. And he, Isaac, behold, now I am old. I know not the day of my death. Notice nowhere in the passage does it say that Isaac is sick or sick unto death. That's a common misconception that people that write commentaries or people that read the Bible, they get an assumption when they read. Isaac here is just saying that he's going to die, but he doesn't know when. Look at the previous verse. I know not when I die. He's just getting ready. The passage here doesn't say that he's sick or sick unto death. Isaac doesn't die for a few many years later. He dies at 180 years of age. If you want to go to Genesis 35, 28. Genesis chapter 35, verse 28. And the days of Isaac were 104 years. That's 180 years. At the time that he goes to bless Esau, it's got to be approximately 20 years before that. So he wasn't sick unto death, or he wasn't dying. He was just getting ready for his death. And people make assumptions when reading, because Isaac is talking about death, that he must surely be dying. You get a man in the Bible named Hezekiah. The Lord brings a man of God and says, you're up because you're going to die within a few years. But you read that story, he repents of his ways, he gets right, and God extends his years 15 more. You say, what is it? No man knoweth the day or the hour of his death. Only God does, except for the select few that God in the Bible has told them when they're going to die. You don't know when you're going to die. I wouldn't want to know when I was going to die. Say, why? I probably wouldn't live as the way God would have me to live. Or if I knew that I was going to die, I'd live in fear. I'd live in certain anticipation. I do know that one day we will die if we don't get translated. It's appointed unto man once to die, the Bible says. But I don't know exactly when I'm going to die, and neither do you. So we live day by day. And that's how the Lord wants us to live, in faith, day by day. We ought to plan for the future. We ought to, like Isaac, set up appropriations for our families. But when it comes to faith, we live day by day. Not knowing when our death is going to be. The fact that Isaac is talking about his death, people assume that he is dying, but he isn't. He's simply just preparing the family for his death. And of course, in verse 2, it says that he knows not when he's going to die. David does this. For example, David thought he was a step away from death. If you would go to 1 Samuel chapter 20, verse 3, and I'll show you what I'm talking about. And David sware moreover and said, thy father certainly knoweth that I have found grace in thine eyes. And he saith, let not Jonathan know this, lest he be grieved. But truly as the Lord liveth, and as thy soul liveth, there is but a step between me and death. So David said, there's a step between me and death. Now when he writes this, he's approximately 24 years of age. Okay. He's approximately 24 years of age, which means that he doesn't die for another 46 years. 1 Chronicles 29, 27. And the time that he, that's David, reigned over Israel was 40 years. 7 years reigned he in Hebron, and 33 years reigned he in Jerusalem. So just because somebody talks of death or talks of their death in the Bible doesn't mean that they're close to dying. That's a long step for David. There's a step between me and death. He says that at 24 years of age, he lives past that event for about 46 years. John Wesley does this. John Wesley was an Anglican who became a Methodist preacher to England and the America, and did a similar thing as David and Isaac. He wrote his epitaph. Now, an epitaph is a phrase or a statement written in memory of a person who has died, or written by the person before their death, especially an inscription on a tombstone. So that's what an epitaph is. And John Wesley writes his epitaph on his tombstone when he is 32 years of age. But he lives past that almost 40 years, well, yeah, about 50-51 years after that. He dies when he's 88. John Wesley, who was an Anglican, became a Methodist preacher to England and America, wrote his epitaph when he was only 32 years of age, yet he lives past that 51 years. An epitaph is a phrase or statement written in memory of a person. An epitaph summarizes a person's life. It summarizes a person's life. John will live 51 years after he wrote his epitaph to die at a ripe old age of 88. And this is John's epitaph. He was buried in England. And I have a copy of his epitaph. Like I said, an epitaph is written either by the person themselves or by someone else that summarizes the person's life. What is an epitaph? Well, here's John Wesley's. John Wesley, A.M., late fellow of Lincoln College, Oxford. This great light arose by the singular providence of God to enlighten these nations and to revive, enforce, and defend the pure apostolic doctrines and practices of the primitive church. Now remember, John Wesley, along with his brother, was a great preacher that turned America around for God, which he continued to do both by his writings and his labors for more than half a century. And to his inexpressible joy, not only beheld their influence extending to their efficacy, witnessed in the hearts and lives of many thousands, as well as in the Western world, as in these kingdoms, but also, far above all human power of expectation, lived to see provision made by the singular grace of God for their continuance and establishment to the joy of future generations. Reader, if thou art constrained to bless the instrument, give God the glory. After having languished a few days, he at length finished his course and his life together, gloriously triumphing over death, March 2nd, Animus Domini, 1791, in the 88th year of his age. And so that epitaph, he wrote before he died, but he wrote many years before he died. What Isaac is doing, he's appropriating his stuff before he dies. People on their tombstones write certain quotes and things like that that summarize their life or what they have done. They do that, or other people do it for them. That's an epitaph. Always loving and always loved. That's one. And that's a good one, you know. And your epitaph. You're going to have an epitaph one day. I'm going to have an epitaph one day on the tombstone if the Lord tarries. Here's another one. She hath done what she could. And that's an epitaph. And, of course, it's taken from the scriptures about the lady that anointed the feet of Jesus. She hath done what she could and given what she had. Does anybody know whose tombstone has that written on? Famous person, a famous Christian. Fanny Crosby, the great hymn writer of yesteryear. Fanny Crosby has a tombstone, and on it is her epitaph. She hath done what she could. That's a good epitaph. That's a good epitaph for a Christian to have. She hath done what she could. You know something is, you can only do what you can. You can't do what you can't. And some deep wisdom right there. And of course, she was a sinner like anybody else. She needed a savior. But Fanny Crosby wrote over 3,000 hymns, many of which we sing today and are the great foundation of a lot of our hymns and our faith. And Fanny Crosby was blind at an early age due to the incompetencies of a doctor. Of course, nowadays, if she grew up now, she'd be bitter against God and have welfare and hate the system. But she grew up, she had a good attitude, a good spirit. She loved the Lord and wrote many hymns, many that we sing that are in the hymn book today. Her epitaph is, she had done what she could. What's your epitaph going to be when you die? I'm going to tell you one that I want, and through prayer, but I haven't earned it yet. If you would, go to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. We're going to read of an epitaph of a man who wrote his epitaph shortly before he died. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. The Apostle Paul's writing here. He's about to be martyred. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Now that's a good epitaph right there. I have fought a good fight, Paul says. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. You know, most believers today in America, their epitaph is, I've avoided the fight. You know, something is, Christianity is a fight, and most Christians, they avoid the fight. You say, what is the fight? It's witnessing for the prerogatives of Christ. You know, most Christians don't witness for Christ. And it comes time to defend the Word of God, to defend the King James. Most people, they don't know much about the King James, they don't know much about the Bible, or they don't have the desire, so they don't defend it. You say, what is that? That's avoiding the fight. That's avoiding the fight. Getting rejected for the name of Christ, getting rejected for the faith of Christ. That's part of fighting the faith. I have missed my course. You know, most people aren't walking in the way that God has had for them to walk. I've seen so many Christians, they've come, especially here at Calvary, they've come to church, they've gotten saved, they grow a bit, and then they're out the door. You say, what is that? They've missed their course. I'm not saying that Christ can't readjust their course down the road, but they're missing it now. I've avoided the fight, I've missed my course, I've betrayed the faith. That is the epitaph of most Christians today. Most Christians, spiritually speaking, have a losing life. Have a losing life. And it's very sad. I'm not saying they're not saved and they're not going to heaven when they die, but they have a losing epitaph. Paul was a fighter. I have fought a good fight. I have fought a good fight. If you will, go to 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 3 through 4, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. A soldier fights. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. You know who I found throughout the years of being a saved, born-again Christian? The people I found to be better Christians are those that are ladies, because they have more of a servant's heart, and soldiers, physical soldiers. You say, why is that? Maybe because soldiers know how to fight. You know, Christianity is a fight. It's a warfare. Paul said, I have fought a good fight. Christianity is a warfare. And here, 2 Timothy chapter 2, it says, thou therefore endure hardness. You know, soldiers have to endure hardness. People in America today can't endure hardness. And that's why they're not good soldiers for Jesus Christ. When you're on the battlefield, it's not always glamour and glory. Sometimes it's grit and guts, and you have to endure that hardness, and you endure the hardness, you can be a good soldier. Paul contended for the faith. If you would go to Jude chapter 1 verse 3. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly pacify the faith. Is that what it says? Earnestly contend for the faith. We're to contend for the faith. Contend means to fight. Earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. Are you contending for the faith this morning in your day-to-day walk, in your life? You know, Paul, he said that he was contending for the faith. He was a fighter. Part of being a Christian is to be that fighter. In your epitaph, I wonder if your epitaph would have that you fought the faith. I have fought a good fight. Paul was a fighter and he contended for the faith. Moses was a fighter. Elijah was a fighter. Peter was a fighter. Paul was a fighter. God himself is said to be a man of war. Are you fighting for the faith? You know, Christianity is not a passive endeavor. I'm going to say that again. Christianity is not a passive endeavor. In other words, you call yourself Christian and you walk the Christian walk, there is going to be a fight. There's always a fight. Those that fight wear a uniform. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, soldiers wear a uniform. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. In order to fight effectively, you need to have the proper armor. Paul wore the armor well. Do you? You know, Barnabas wore the armor well. Do you? Silas wore the armor well. You can't fight without armor. You're gonna get taken out. Christianity is not a passive endeavor. There is a spiritual warfare. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. For we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing. This is the warfare. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing it into captivity, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. The warfare is against thoughts, against imaginations, against spiritual wickedness. But there's a fight. You have to war a good warfare. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 18, this charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy. He gives him a charge. He gives him a go for it, a go get it. This charge I commit unto thee, my son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou might by them mightest war a good warfare. Are you warring a good warfare? Are you putting up a fight? You know, one thing is, I said this, the devil's going to come against you. He's going to attack you and your life. He's going to attack this church. But by God, don't go down without a fight. By God, don't go down without a fight. And that's been part of my motto and theme, is if we have to go down, we're going down with a fight, a good warfare. This warfare raged so heavy that hell knew about this warfare. If you will go to Acts chapter 19, verse 15, and the evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are ye? When the seven sons of Sceva tried to commit the exorcism, the fake and phony religious act, like they do today, the devils didn't know who they were, but they knew who Paul was, because Paul was contending for the faith. You know something? When you fight the faith, the devil knows who you are. When you fight the faith, the enemy knows who you are. And you know who the enemy is. And I believe that this morning, if you're fighting the faith with rigor, and you're fighting it with vigor, and you're fighting a good warfare, the devil has your number, just as much as the Lord does, because you're his enemy. When you punch somebody and you become their adversary, you don't just not know who they are. You know them more. If you've ever gotten in a fight, I've gotten in a fight, you know who you're fighting. If you're engaged in a warfare. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, I have fought a good fight, Paul says. Here's the next part of his epitaph. I have finished my course. I have finished my course. You know something? Is Paul wasn't afraid of hard work. We have a lot of Christians and preachers, people in the ministry that are afraid of hard work. They're afraid of going out and doing the work of God. Paul wasn't afraid of that. He did it right till his martyrdom stopped him. He finished his course. You know something? Is Christ finished his course? John chapter 19, verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. It is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Finish something. All right? Finish. You start something, finish it. Jesus Christ was a finisher. Paul was a finisher. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We need to finish things, folks. We need to. You know, Mom would always tell me this, you start things in gladness and end them with disdain. What does that mean? That means that you start something and then you get frustrated or you get bored with it and you just leave it and you don't finish it. Finish something. Finish the course that God has laid for you. Christ finished his course. Paul finished his course. This church building, we can worship in it and we can preach in it because somebody and people finished this building. You know, the Bible says that lest haply after they laid the foundation, they were not able to finish the building. The people will what? Mock. You know something? A house half finished, you can't live in it. very well. If you don't finish your course, you have no power. In Nehemiah's day, the people had a mind to work, and they finished the wall. Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 6, "So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto the half thereof, for the people had a mind to work." People had a mind to work. You know why people, you know why things are left unfinished? It's because people don't work. They don't have a mind to work. Paul finished his course because he had a mind to finish it. Christ finished his course. The nation of Israel finished the wall. You know, things are more blessed and things are better when they're finished. Don't just start something and quit halfway through. You say, what's one thing that you can finish? Well, one thing you can finish is your Bible reading. Read it from Genesis to Revelation, from cover to cover. You say, yeah, I already did that. Then do it again. Finish something. Don't just start something, finish it. Better is the end of something than the beginning thereof. We need to finish. We need to be finishers. And that's part of our epitaph. There's a lot of people that are going to die, saved people that did not finish their course. They started off strong and they got saved and they walked with the Lord and then they backslid. You say, what is it? They didn't finish. And the last part of Paul's epitaph before he dies is this. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7, "I have kept the faith." I have kept the faith. What will be your life's epitaph? You know, when Paul died, he died in faith. He died believing the book. He died preaching the book. He died believing the God of the book. He died in faith. I have kept the faith. What will be your epitaph when you die? When I die? If you will, go back to Genesis chapter 27, verse 2. Isaac, nonetheless, has his epitaph and also making his appropriations. And he said, "Behold, now I am old. I know not the day of my death." He doesn't know when he's going to die, but he's making preparations. No man knows when he's going to die, except for the rare exceptions in the Bible. If you will, go to James chapter 4, verse 14. It says this, "Whereas you know now what shall be on the morrow, for what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time, then vanisheth away. For that ye ought to say, if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. Whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow." We don't know what tomorrow is going to bring forth. We don't know what's going to be beyond the grave. We don't know what each day is going to be. We have, like I said, what makes us separate from animals is we can have hope of the future. We can plan for the future. We can look to the future. But we don't always know what the future holds as the immediate future. That's why we got to live by faith. We got to live by faith through the Word of God. Through the Word of God. Isaac doesn't know when the exact day of his death is, but he's doing the right thing. He's planning for the future. Unfortunately, his preparation was in carnality. Isaac's carnality, along with Esau's foolishness and Jacob's supplanting and Rebekah's undermining, are going to unfold some interesting things in their home life. You know, a lot of times home life has issues not because of just one person's sin. Now, it could just be one person's sin. The Bible says one sinner doeth much hurt. But generally, 9 times out of 10, divorces, marital difficulties, and strife in the home are caused by multiple parties at some point. And here, what we're going to see as it unfolds in Genesis chapter 27 is we're going to see the unfolding of a dysfunctional family. Boy, there's a lot of those in America today, aren't there? Well, this dysfunctional family is going to be due to the people's multiple people's sins. And here we're going to look at Esau, Isaac, Rebekah, and Jacob. And they're all guilty parties in this. We always want to claim innocence. Now, I understand that there are blameless people in a relationship where they're not to blame, but for all have sinned. We've all sinned and we all do sin, and a lot of times our sin makes a bad situation worse. And here we're going to see how the unfolding of people's sins are going to cause destruction. Rebekah undermines Isaac's authority, and Rebekah chooses favorites. Isaac chooses favorites. Esau despises his birthright and doesn't care about spiritual things. Type of a lost man or a carnal Christian. And Jacob is going to supplant and undermine his brother. All working against each other. Selfishness. You know what gets in is selfishness. And selfishness gets in, then you get the roots of destruction in the home. Back in Genesis, I don't have it up on the screen, but back in Genesis 27, we're going to start looking at the unfolding of some damage. What we're about to delve into is a typical 21st century American home. I mean, a dysfunctional family. They're one and the same, for the most part. Most homes in America today are dysfunctional. They're falling apart because God is not the ruler of their home. And they're not the ruler of each individual. You want your home to be at peace? You want to have a peaceful home? Start with yourself. Have God to be the, first of all, Lord needs to be your Savior. Second of all, He needs to be Lord over your life. You need to be following His laws, His rules, His precepts, walking in His Spirit. You worry about yourself, and if each person listening to my voice followed and walked in the Spirit, you'd have peace everywhere. You'd have peace in your home because you would be walking in the Spirit, your family members would be walking in the Spirit, and everybody would get along. But the problem, the fact is we don't walk in the Spirit. We don't walk after the precepts of God. So therefore, we walk in our selfishness and our lusts, and we bite and devour one another. Back in Genesis 27, I don't have it up on the screen. Pick it up in verse 6, and it says, "And Rebekah spake unto Jacob her son, saying, Behold, I heard thy father speak unto Esau thy brother, saying, Bring me venison, and make me savory meat, that I may eat and bless thee before the Lord before my death. Now therefore, my son, obey my voice according to that which I command thee. Go now to the flock, and fetch me from thence two good kids of the goats, and I will make them savory meat for thy father, such as he loveth, and thou shalt bring it to thy father, that he may eat, and that he may bless thee before his death. And Jacob said to Rebekah his mother, Behold, Esau my brother is a hairy man, and I am a smooth man. My father peradventure will feel me, and I shall seem to him as a deceiver, and I shall bring a curse upon me, and not a blessing." Jacob understands something. He understands that what he's doing is deceptive and wrong, but he understands that if he gets caught, it's going to be worse. And next week, where we're going to pick up is we're going to pick up right here. We're going to pick up in a dysfunctional family, how to make a dysfunctional family. And I encourage you to come. I encourage you to listen. I encourage you to partake of this message and to learn from it, especially if you're in a family that is dysfunctional, or a family that's fallen apart, or a family that has fallen apart. Because I'm going to tell you this, in America today, most families are falling apart. And the reason why, like I said before, is because God is not on the throne of your heart. Here we see, and this is an example of a Christian family. I'm talking to Christians this morning. I'm not even talking to the lost world. I'm talking to professing, born-again Christians, where the family is falling apart. Everybody claims to be saved. Everybody claims to have a love for God. Well, if you have a love for God, why are you hating each other? And that's where we're going to pick up next week. I encourage you to come. I encourage you to listen and grow. And it might help your family. It might help your walk with the Lord. And if you're not saved, it might bring you to the knowledge of salvation, which is the most important thing. Any questions this morning on the Bible study? All right, we'll close with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for all that you've given to us. We thank you for your word. Lord, we pray that we would take what has been preached to heart. Lord, Heavenly Father, we pray that we would be kind one to another, tender-hearted, kindly affectioned. And Lord, pray that we would fight the fight of faith. Lord, that our epitaph would be the same as the Apostle Paul's. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Lord, we thank you for all these things. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen.